Good evening. A lot of progress on last month's cases. Let's see if together we can do just as well tonight. We've three new reconstructions, security pictures and exhibits peppered with clues that we hope you'll recognise. If you do, the detectives gathered here behind me are waiting for your call.
And as usual, the cases we've reconstructed are three serious crimes where police are most anxious for any information you can provide. Greater Manchester Police are looking for the murderer of 18-year-old Michelle Wareing, who was last seen alive after leaving Scott's Disco in the centre of Wigan, where she'd been dancing with friends. Police in Northumbria are appealing for anybody who saw three men as they made their getaway on motorbikes through the streets of Newcastle upon Tyne after an armed raid on a busy travel agency. And the Metropolitan Force need help to stop a man who's been trying to trick his way into women's homes in prosperous parts of London. Detectives believe the same man is responsible for at least eight attacks, including one rape.
Last month's Crimewatch led to seven arrests as a direct result of viewers' calls, and there's been one additional arrest that was unconnected with our appeals. We'll give you details later. But if you saw the programme last month, you must have been intrigued about the abduction of a man near Runcorn. A company executive was bundled into the boot of his Jaguar and driven off. A viewer rang in, naming a man police had interviewed already, but who'd had an alibi. He was seen again, and two men have now been charged with kidnapping and robbery, and a third man with perverting the course of justice.
Well, the first of our main cases tonight is the reconstruction of the last evening 18-year-old Michelle Wareing was seen alive. On a warm September evening, Michelle disappeared after spending a Saturday night out with friends in Wigan. Our film begins at around noon the following day, Sunday, September the 10th, at Station Road car park just outside Wigan town centre.
Are you not going down there to that old handbag, are you?
Oh, come on, the man, money in it.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
What's that? Find your handbag.
Hang on. Let's have a look at it. And we'll take it to the police. There's some shoes there as well. They might have something to do with this handbag.
Okay then, Mrs. Wareing, just to recap, it's your daughter Michelle Wareing, 18 years. She's been missing since Saturday night, Sunday morning. Yes, that's right. Okay, I'll get an officer around straight away. Bye-bye. This could have found property, please. Thank you.
Some of my son found the bag. About 2 yards further on is where I found a pair of shoes.
So let's just split up and have a look round.
OK, then. I'll go on this side and look round this way a bit.
OK.
Michelle had been missing for nearly 2 days.
Over here!
Her body was found in the bushes beside the car park in Station Road. Michelle lived at home with her parents and younger brother near the centre of Wigan. She worked as a waitress at a local cafe, and everyone who knew her describes a cheerful, popular teenager. On the evening of Saturday, September the 9th, Michelle and two of her friends had planned a night out.
Michelle!
She'd arranged to meet Sharon Pryke and Alison Humphreys in the town centre at 7:30.
OK.
I have to put mine first, OK?
OK.
We'll talk about
it. Have 3 hours of lunch, please.
The three of them visited several popular pubs and bars in the centre of Wigan before finally arriving at Scott's Disco at about 10:15. Michelle's friends remember her as her usual happy self that night, but towards 1 o'clock in the morning, she'd become tired.
Why? Where are you going?
I'm going home.
Why?
I'm fed up, I've had enough.
Oh, don't be stupid. How are you getting home?
Walking it.
Michelle, get a taxi. Remember what happened to that man in Wigan?
I'll be all right, honest.
Promise me you'll get a taxi.
Okay.
Anyway, I'll have to go now. I'll see you later. Bye.
Ta-ra.
As Michelle left the club, Alison and her boyfriend were already outside waiting for a taxi.
Can you take us to Kit Green, please? Okay.
As they drove away, Alison saw her friend walking up King Street towards Wallgate. Where Michelle went next and exactly what happened to her, police can at present only speculate. Did she take a taxi on Wallgate? Did she accept a lift from somebody? Police need to hear from you if you saw her getting into a taxi or a car. Or perhaps she met up with somebody she knew who may have offered to walk with her the mile and a half home. One witness reports seeing a girl like Michelle standing next to McDonald's 400 yards from Scott's. She was with a man described as 6 foot tall, slim with short blonde hair and wearing jeans and a light patterned jumper. Minutes after that, two separate witnesses saw a couple arguing outside the multi-storey car park at Station Road. One witness particularly remembers the girl's white shoulder bag. Several other people report hearing screams and shouts coming from the car park. The multi-story itself was nearly empty by now. Was yours one of the few cars still parked there? And if so, did you hear or see anything unusual? At about 2:30 that morning, David Bradshaw was walking home down Station Road when he saw a young man near the exit of the car park. As David continued on his way, another young man, tall with short blonde hair, ran out in front of him from the entrance of the car park and up towards the town centre. And this was just 50 yards from where, the following Monday evening, Michelle's body was found. Detective Superintendent John Smith is leading this investigation. What was the motive?
I believe this to be a very violent, sexually motivated attack.
Could there have been an incident at Scott's Disco, you think, leading up to her leaving before her friends and maybe leading on to this incident?
Inquiries have not revealed any incident in Scott's. I believe that Michelle Wareing was very tired and that is the reason she went home.
If Michelle had decided, against her friend's advice, to walk home, what route would she have taken?
She would probably retrace the steps she took in coming into Wigan that night. That's by walking back through the town centre towards her home in Welly.
So, in fact, that car park would have been out of her way if she was walking home?
That is correct, it would be, yes. It's about 800 yards away from the disco.
How far was that car park from Scott's?
About 10 minutes walk at the most, probably 8 minutes average.
We can see there where Michelle was found.
That is the star, yes.
The entrance and the exit to the car park.
That is correct, yes.
That exit, a man was seen leaning over the railings and you're particularly anxious to find him.
Yes, I certainly am. I would very much like to eliminate this man from the inquiry and urge him to come forward. He's a young man, late teens, light coloured clothing, and he may well have been in that area of the car park for some length of time, maybe hours, prior to this particular sighting. If anybody knows this man's identity, please contact the incident room immediately.
And someone else was seen near the exit, at the entrance to the car park?
That is correct. A man with blonde hair, about 6 foot, blue jeans, dark pullover, ran from that direction towards the town centre.
And another sighting too around that time?
Yes, that is correct. There was a couple walking along at Riverway with a dog when a man brushed past them, again a man with blonde hair. And again, I would urge these people, if they recognise themselves, to contact us on the incident room at Wigan Police Station.
Now, those couples who were seen arguing, are you sure that they were Michelle or not?
No, in fact, we're not. Neither of the young ladies has been positively identified as Michelle. Although both were wearing dark coloured clothing, the sighting at McDonald's, we know that the blouse that the young lady was wearing there was very, very similar indeed to Michelle's. But again, I would appeal to these people, if they do recognise themselves as being outside McDonald's or outside the car park arguing, please contact us.
Could save a lot of vital police work there.
It certainly would do.
Incidentally, to help you remember, Wigan were playing at home football against Northampton that night. That might help to jog your memory. Finally, briefly, there's a red car at the car park too, which might be significant.
Yes, the Ford Orion was seen parked on Riverway by the multi-storey. The index number of the vehicle began with an E and ended with an E. It was quite a new car.
Right, Mr. Smith, for the moment, thank you. And of course, most importantly, if you think you may have seen Michelle herself in the small hours of that Saturday night after she left Scott's, remember it was Saturday night, September the 9th, Sunday the 10th. Please do call us. Even the slightest piece of information could make all the difference in helping police work out exactly what did happen to Michelle that night. The number direct to the studio here is 01811 8055, or you can contact Detective Superintendent Smith's colleagues at the incident room in Wigan on 061 855 7039. That's 061, the code for Manchester, 855 7039.
Last month's reconstructions had a huge response. I've already mentioned the arrests in connection with the Runcorn kidnap. The other cases are still under investigation. 180 viewers called about the security van robbery in Shipley, and detectives are checking several sightings of the car used in the attack. They've also been offered names of individuals and teams of criminals who might have been responsible. There are also suspects being checked now for the robbery near Matlock. A couple were attacked in their own home in the village of Cromford. Detectives are sorting their way through no fewer than 250 contributions from Crimewatch viewers.
And there have been several developments from last month's photocall. West Mercia police wanted to question a man about company frauds, and information from Crimewatch viewers sent them to an address in Torquay. After further inquiries as a result of that visit, a man presented himself at police headquarters in Worcester. He's now been charged with one case of obtaining services by deception and another of obtaining goods by deception.
On another photocall case, a man has been arrested for robbery and firearms offences after 20 viewers thought they recognised him. We showed a security video of raids on North London building societies. Five of our callers gave detailed information about one individual. And as a result, police went to an address in North London. The arrested man now faces 22 separate charges.
Well, now this month's photocall, with pictures, some taken on security camera, of people whom police would like to contact. Here's Superintendent David Hatcher.
First, we need your help to find this couple. On Monday the 20th of March, they went into two branches of Thomas Cook in Hertfordshire and tried to get £7,000 worth of travellers' cheques. They used two building society cheques, which had been obtained earlier that day, using a stolen building society passbook. Both times, the couple left Thomas Cook empty-handed when staff got suspicious. The woman is 20 to 25 years old, 5'6" tall, of medium build, and with long dark hair tied up in a bun. The man is also 20 to 25, 5'9" tall, well-dressed and well-spoken, and he wears an earring in his right ear. If you recognise them, please call. Next, officers from Sussex are anxious to find Richard Denick, who was serving a life sentence for murder at Lewes Prison. On Saturday the 30th of September, he escaped from the prison by scaling a 17-foot perimeter wall. Later that night, he gate-crashed a party in St Anne's Crescent, Lewes. But where has he been since then? He's 22 years old, 5'10" tall, slim build with ginger hair, although he may have dyed his hair black by now. He's considered dangerous and should not be approached. But if you think you know where he is, please get in touch with us. And on the 28th of July, these two men robbed the National Westminster Bank in Kingston-upon-Thames, Surrey. They brandished guns and herded customers into one end of the bank. The masked man had long, untidy, mousy hair. As they left, he dropped his sawn-off shotgun and it went off, but luckily no one was hurt. Take a closer look at his accomplice. Both robbers are in their early 20s, 5'9" tall and slim to medium build. There is a reward, so if you've seen these men, please call us now. Finally, Grampian Police in Scotland would like to speak to Paul James Bennett. He may have information about a fraud that occurred in the Aberdeen area in June of this year. Mr. Bennett may be using a blue and white Hughes 500D helicopter, number Golf 010 Whiskey. This was last seen flying over Northampton in mid-October. Mr. Bennett is 26, 5'6" tall, with short, dark, curly hair and a mole under his mouth. He has a strong New Zealand accent. If you know him, or any of our other photo call faces, please call us now.
If you do recognise any of those people, the number to ring here is 01811 8055. That's 01811 8055.
Now to two events that at first seemed wholly unconnected, but as the story unfolds, a link emerges which adds a particularly serious dimension to what turned out in any case to be a worrying crime. The common factor is a stolen car, a Ford Sierra 4x4, which had been taken from Carlisle in April. In the reconstruction that follows, two key witnesses recount what happened. One is a retired policeman who lives in Newcastle-upon-Tyne. The other is a householder, Jean Watson, who lives 20 miles away in Ovingham. It's 10 p.m, Friday, the 5th of May.
I was watching the news, then the doorbell rang. Normally I wouldn't answer it, but it rang repeatedly, so I thought it was the lady next door, and this young chap was standing on the path.
There's been a burglary at number 48. Can you come?
No, there is no 48.
There is. It's just around the corner.
No, go for the police.
You must come. It's in a right mess.
I can't come. I'll phone the police from here. So I came in, dialed 999. Nothing happened. That was when I sort of panicked. So I came upstairs and looked out of the bedroom window, and he was still standing on the path. How long he stood there, I can't remember. And then this other figure appeared, ran in front of him from round the other side of the porch.
Mrs. Watson watched as a vehicle drew up and noted down its registration. But it was 3 months before this car was seen again. Tuesday, August the 15th. This is Greystoke Gardens in Newcastle. The story is taken up by a former sergeant, Bob Murray.
A car drove up about 20 to 3 and parked opposite my flat. It was a strange car, and I watched the man get out. He was a stranger as well. He locked the car, walked across the road in front of me, adjusted his shoelace, and I noticed he appeared to have green suede shoes. He went along to the garages. I didn't think anything about that, but within seconds I was aware of him going past my flat, went to the next block, Mountwood, and I know well enough that the side door of that block is kept locked, and sure enough I expected him to come out the front, which he did, and walk briskly away across the grass.
It's now less than 2 hours later at a travel agency in Newcastle city centre.
Got any jobs?
I've got a client going to China. Get him! Right, go for it! Get down!
Minutes after the robbery, these bikes were seen at Greystoke Gardens. The most direct route would have been down John Dobson Street, into St Mary's Place, and onto Sandiford Road. At some point, somewhere on the journey, they dropped off the pillion passenger and the money. They turned right into Goldspink Road, Springbank Road, and onto Greystoke Gardens Estate.
I was just rising from this chair to switch the television on, and as I rose, there was a road of motorcycles coming past, and I just saw two motorcycles disappearing round behind the garages. Within about 20 seconds, one of the men, who appeared to be the same man who had left the car, but dressed differently, walked back towards the car. Started the car, reversed it quickly into the lane. And then it was almost immediately driven away. And I noticed his passenger was still wearing a crash helmet. Just before 6 o'clock, I saw a young man walking up towards the garages. He walked out of my sight for a few seconds and came back again. At 6:30, I saw the same young man going along towards the garages again. On this occasion, he was carrying a black crash helmet. And within 10, 15 seconds, he drove away on the larger of the motorbikes. And just turned 10 to 7, the same young fella came back again with the crash helmet and took the second bike away.
Mr. Stevenson, what was the connection between the man at Mrs. Watson's door in Ovingen in May and that raid in the centre of Newcastle in August?
Well, it was the same car for a start. And Mrs. Watson, she worked at Callas Pegasus as a cashier. And it's my belief that the visit to her house, when she had her telephone wires cut at the same time, mind, was perhaps to try to get into the house, thinking that she had perhaps information or, in fact, a key to the premises, which wasn't the case. But that's what we believe the connection is.
Now, that linking car, then, that Ford Sierra 4x4, silver, where was it kept between May and August? A distinctive vehicle, those 4x4s, and certainly with that number, C952MCN.
Indeed, that's what we're trying to find out. It'd be very interesting to know, and that's what we're asking members of the public, where was that vehicle between the 22nd of April, when it was stolen from Carlisle, and, in fact, the 15th of August, when it was involved in the robbery?
Probably the Newcastle area, you suspect?
Or, I would think, almost certainly.
Now, the driver got a reasonable description, and our graphics people have made a Crimewatch video fit. There he is. All these people in their 20s, weren't they?
Yes, indeed.
And all very short?
Well, certainly, we think about the 5'8" would be maximum. Perhaps there would be one slightly taller than that.
OK, and they might have a lot of money on them since August the 15th, some of it perhaps in foreign currency. What about the two motorbikes? They've not been found, have they?
No, they haven't. These motorcycles, they were certainly put in the garage and they were moved from there. And the chap who moved them was only away 20 minutes from the first time he moved them till he came back for the second cycle. So we think that they were perhaps re-garaged rather close to the scene.
There's a Honda CBR 1000F, that's the red and black one, and a Yamaha Tenere 600cc trials bike, that's the white one on the right.
Yes,
and these were abandoned during the robbery. You might have heard the robber say, get the bags, get the bags.
That's
they obviously
right.
wanted to get these
that's
back.
That's right, they were very anxious to get the bags back. And these were actually abandoned at Callas Pegasus.
Now, this one's Carlton, this blue one, that grey one, and it's quite a big one.
It's
a regatta.
Yes, indeed.
Of course, somebody might recognise these.
Yes, they're rather
stolen
large.
From them or
we're hoping
them.
That whoever perhaps used to own these bags will get in touch with us, and perhaps that will lead us to who we're looking for.
OK. Potentially a lot of violence in that raid. Here's the number if you can help, 01811 8055, or you can call the incident room in Newcastle. That's 091 222 1777. Please ask for the serious crimes incident room. That's 091, the code for Newcastle, 222 1777.
And another incident room number for you, if you have any information on where Michelle Wareing might have gone after she left Scott's Disco on the early hours Saturday the 9th of September, Sunday the 10th of September. The number is 0942 44981. That's 0942, the code for Wigan, 44981. That's in addition to the Manchester number I gave out earlier on. We have had some calls on that case already. One call, for example, here is a caller who spotted a girl who might have been talking to Michelle Wareing outside a disco. So could this caller please ring back and leave a contact number for us? Right. As a result of last month's programme, I can report another arrest in connection with one of our photocall cases. We showed a picture of a man wanted for questioning in connection with a stolen company chequebook. At 2:02, just an hour and a half after our main programme came off the air, police arrested a man in Peterborough. The man is now in custody, charged with 8 offences, including theft, burglary and forgery.
9 months ago, we showed a reconstruction of events leading up to a dreadful crime that happened last December. A photographer, Lorraine Benson, had been murdered after spending the evening at a staff Christmas party in South London. Several people had heard screams, but did nothing to intervene. Crimewatch viewers helped police narrow down the inquiry. Eventually, though, forensic evidence pointing to a suspect who lived a mile from where Lorraine was killed. As you may have seen in the papers 2 weeks ago, John Michael Paul Dunn appeared at the Old Bailey and pleaded guilty to the murder. He was sentenced to life imprisonment, and in addition was sentenced for assaulting a police officer, drunk driving and attempted burglary. Several other counts, including rape, or attempted rape at any rate, were left on file. The judge said to Mr. Dunn, "You must not be released until it is certain beyond doubt that you will not constitute a danger to women. If that means you should be detained for the rest of your life, so be it."
After an appeal we made in September last year, thanks to information from a Crimewatch viewer, police were able to arrest a man who had beaten a woman to death in Runcorn. The viewer gave an address in Leeds, but when police got there, the murder suspect fled, and after a chase across rooftops, there was a violent struggle. One officer was seriously injured. On the 17th of last month, at Chester Crown Court, Barry Mackay was found guilty of murder. He was sentenced to life imprisonment.
But now to Incident Desk, where we invite police to appeal to you directly. Here's Superintendent David Hatcher.
First, Durham police need your help to solve a robbery that took place at Hampstead service station on the outskirts of Consett on Wednesday the 13th of September. It was just after 9 o'clock in the evening when three men burst into the owner's home on the garage forecourt and demanded money. There was a struggle during which the garage owner's wrist was broken, but he was able to provide an artist's impression of one of the raiders, who's described as in his mid-30s and 5'10" tall. Now, he wore a distinctive donkey jacket with orange shoulder flaps and this white safety helmet, which he left behind. The second raider was 6 feet tall, large build, and wore a green NATO-style jumper. The third was 5'7" tall, tubby, with fair hair, and wore a copper-coloured anorak. All three had Tyneside accents. The robbers grabbed the day's takings and escaped in an orange larder, similar to this. It may have an A and possibly an X in the number. They drove off towards Rowland's Gill, but that car has still not been found. So if you recognise this man or have any information about the robbery, please call us now. Next, can you help solve the murder of Elizabeth McCormack, who was found dead in her flat in Ilford, Essex, on Friday the 22nd of September? Elizabeth was last seen alive on Tuesday the 19th, when she left work at about 6:30 p.m. to head home. She probably got the central line from Oxford Circus to Liverpool Street and then changed on to the British Rail line to Ilford, arriving there between 7:15 and 7:30 p.m. Perhaps you saw Elizabeth that evening. She was wearing a bright cerise pink skirt and a white shirt. After crossing over Cranbrook Road, she would have walked down Balfour Road, where there's a taxi rank. If you got a taxi there that night, you might remember her. She would have arrived at her flat at around 7:30, and we think she was murdered shortly after going inside. It seems that Elizabeth's attacker climbed over a gate beside her house. Between 7:30 and 8 p.m, a witness remembers seeing a man he thinks was Asian and about 5'8", walking down Belgrave Road, which is not far from her flat. His clothes seem to be covered in blood, so it's vital that we trace this man and talk to anyone who saw Elizabeth walking home on Tuesday the 19th of September. If you've any information that might help us solve this murder, then please phone us now. And if you've recently been offered property bearing one of these crests, you could help my colleagues in Avon and Somerset solve a £20,000 robbery at a Jacobean manor house. The manor house has been the home of the Fox family since 1924, and the present owner is Lloyd Howard Fox. During the night of Wednesday the 16th of August, three men got into the manor house, waking Mr. Fox's assistant. Now, they're described as in their late 20s, 5'10" to 6 feet tall, with London accents. One of them guarded him for about 4.5 hours while the robbery took place, and during that time, the robber's conversation showed he knew a lot about the Marines. The raiders left at about 4 a.m. in Mr. Fox's car, a blue Volvo which was found abandoned later that morning at the Gordano service station on the M5 just south of Bristol. They took with them jewellery, coins and a safe containing stamps. The collection of penny black, tuppenny blue and penny red stamps is alone worth £5,000. Also stolen was a 2.5 foot long oak and silver spade commemorating George V's coronation. Most of the items are inscribed with one of the Fox family crests or the initials LF. So, if you've been offered anything bearing these crests, please get in touch.
And if you can help with information on any of those cases, please ring us 01 811 8055. That's 01 811 8055.
A lot of calls coming in as a result of a photo call appeal earlier on. Paul Bennett, who was the man wanted in connection with some possible fraud inquiries, who had a helicopter. His helicopter seems to be sighted all over the place, as does the murderer who escaped from Lewes Prison, Richard Denick, who's appeared in various parts of the country. Currently, there's a man who's convinced he saw him in Huddersfield last Sunday. And on Michelle Wareing, police are very anxious that the caller using the name Glenroy should call back immediately. Now, always among the most upsetting sorts of violent crimes are those which take place in the victim's own home. Attacks like this by intruders really are very rare, but when they do occur, they often leave the victims feeling insecure and without any place of refuge. Helen Phelps now takes up the story of a series of such attacks in the hope that you might be able to solve them.
Police are investigating six incidents which have happened in and around the London area and which they believe are connected. The most recent attack took place here in St John's Wood during the evening of Thursday, October the 5th. The victim was threatened with a knife and a gun. The raiders stole Rolex watches similar to these, gold bracelets, cash and a cash card.
He made his getaway that night in the family car, a silver Golf GL. Police think he drove it to Kensington High Street, where he used the victim's cash card at Lloyd's Bank. At 10:31 that night, the maximum amount of £100 was withdrawn. The car was later found abandoned half a mile away in Blomfield Road, Little Venice.
Now, the description we've got does, in fact, vary from scene to scene, but primarily we're looking for a person who's about 5'4", 5'6" tall. We believe on one of the occasions, certainly, he's either Southern European or French Moroccan or Algerian, because he spoke with a fairly strong French accent. At the same time, though, we're trying to connect this particular incident with several other incidents in East Sheen, three in the Barnes area, one in the Shepherd's Bush area, and, of course, the one at St John's Wood.
The first incident took place in February here in Barnes, southwest London.
I'd been shopping that afternoon and had come back because I was quite tired and was lying on the couch because I was intending to go out to a party that evening.
Yeah? I live in the flat upstairs and I've got a leak. Have you got a bucket I could borrow?
Yeah, sure, I'll have a look.
When he pushed past me with the pan, I was so surprised that it didn't really... I just thought, what's he doing? I mean, why is he doing this? Then when he pulled the knife, I remember thinking it was just like in a movies or something like that, and I thought, this isn't happening to me. I just thought it wasn't me that was involved.
I want a cup of tea.
All right, if I get you a cup of tea, will you go then?
I felt he was just biding time. He was almost just waiting to see how things turned out, almost as though he was going through different stages.
Have you got some money?
Yes, a little.
Where?
Although he was quite calm at first, as time went on, he became more menacing.
I realised that I wasn't going to get out of it as lightly as I thought. I reacted by pushing him away, and I saw one of my neighbours.
This man was desperate. By this stage, he had panicked. The victim on this occasion was at the front door. She was screaming, making a lot of noise. There were people in the vicinity that were coming to his help, to her help. The only way out was through that window, and he went that way. Turned right, went towards Hammersmith Bridge and across it. As he jumped through the window, we know he hurt himself because we found some blood at the scene. But what we're appealing for is anybody who might have seen a person later on that evening with glass on him, possibly with a cut. And we know from experience that if a person jumps through a window, he's going to have glass all over him, especially his hair.
Following that incident, there were five more attacks. All followed a similar pattern. But the most serious incident so far happened on Tuesday, the 26th of September, again in Barnes. It was about 8:30 in the evening. She wondered where the noise came from and went downstairs to check the doors and windows. She was confronted by a man with a knife. He demanded her cash and jewellery and stayed with her for nearly 2 hours. During that time, he raped her.
And he came into the house, he was looking for particular types of jewellery. During the course of the events, when he saw the lady, she tried to fob him off with cheaper stuff, but he knew exactly what he was looking for, and he went for some valuable property. There was a Mappingham Webb Christmas edition watch, 1986, and that's valued at about £250. But we have, in fact, got the serial number to that.
The serial number is 1921-4884.
In addition, he took a lady's bracelet, which matched these earrings. And they had identical links to this, about 10 or 12. And again, that's quite valuable and quite distinctive. He specifically asked the victim whether she had a motor vehicle, which she identified as a Volvo Turbo outside. He took the keys and went in the car. He drove up Castle No, we believe, to over Hammersmith Bridge, onto Hammersmith Flyover, along Talgarth Road, Cromwell Road, to Gloucester Road, where he turned left. He then went up there and parked on the north side of Cornwall Gardens. And that was is within about 50 yards of where the Barclays Bank was, and he obtained £200 cash, which was the maximum, because he was quite persistent at the house as to how much he could draw at any one time. Hence, he drew £200. And that was at 10:31 that evening. And then just after midnight on the following day, he was at the Edgware Road, Barclays Bank, where he withdrew another £200. Now, I don't think he had the vehicle at this stage, and it's quite natural for him to have gone down to Gloucester Road and to have caught the tube, either the Circle Line or the District Line, which takes him straight round to Edgware Road. He obviously knows where the cash machines are, so I'm wondering whether, in fact, he's worked in these areas, or he's got friends in these areas, or he socialises in these areas. Certainly, my own view is, when he took the last £200 at 18 minutes past midnight, there he is with £400 in his pocket. He's got no transport, because he certainly didn't have the Volvo at that stage. Where's he going to go from there? I personally think that he lives not too far from that location, because he's got to get home.
So police think he may live in North London, yet he seems familiar with routes all around the London area. Cast your mind back to the evening of Tuesday, the 26th of September.
Maybe you saw this black Volvo 480, which was stolen by the raider in Barnes, travelling across London and being abandoned here in Cornwall Gardens at the junction with Gloucester Road.
Or did you see a man on Saturday, February the 4th, running over Hammersmith Bridge? He may have arrived home with cuts or had glass in his hair. Perhaps you saw a silver Golf on the evening of October the 5th being driven along Kensington High Street.
And in the last week, there have been two further attacks. Mr. Shorter, one of them a very serious one.
Well, the first one was on Friday. It's burglar disturbed, woman screams and runs from the house, and he makes good his escape. Nothing stolen.
That was near Barnes?
That was in Barnes, and that was a couple of hundred yards from the rape in September.
OK. Another one last night?
Yeah. This was more serious. A couple at home, a man comes in, attacks both occupants, steals property, cash, jewellery, credit cards, cash cards, steals the occupant's car, and then makes good his escape.
Now, that was near Chiswick Bridge. All of this is in the sort of West London area. This time, he took those cash cards to one place in the city, in Fenchurch Street, around midnight.
Yes.
And the other one back to Edgware Road.
He went back to the Edgware Road, and at 37 minutes past midnight, he obtains another £100.
Let's take a look at this video fit again. He's very short, this chap, isn't he?
Yes, he is. We think he's made a training appearance. On this particular occasion, we haven't fully interviewed the witnesses yet, but he's about 5'5", fits the description, but the method is identical.
OK, and remember, North African or French accent, which the police think is genuine. If you think you know who this is, or if you can help in any way, please don't stay silent. This man is very dangerous. 01-811-8055. Please call us now. Or you can ring the incident room at Earlsfield. That's 01-672-9922. Ask for Earlsfield incident room, 01-672-9922.
Well, now for our second file of photocall faces. Here again is Superintendent Hatcher.
First, Dorset police need to find this couple. They stole over £5,000 worth of property from a jeweller's in Christchurch on Saturday the 16th of September. The couple, who spoke little English, created a distraction in the shop whilst they took cash and cheques from the till and pieces of jewellery from the display counters. They looked Arabic or Asian and were both in their early 30s. The man is about 5'9" tall and the woman is 5'2". She was wearing a full-length brown fur coat over a multicoloured sari. They may also have information about a number of similar thefts at jewellers throughout the country, so if you recognise them, give us a call. Next, we'd like your help to find Paul Charles Ridlington Cook. We think he might be able to help us clear up a fraud involving £1 million worth of furniture. In April, a company called Wood Street Furnishings moved to this warehouse in Southwold Road, Watford. Large orders were placed on credit for furniture like this, but all the furniture was then sold and the creditors never paid. Paul Cook is 42, 5'10" tall and of stocky build. He has thinning light brown hair and is a heavy smoker and drinker. If you've seen him, call us. The flying squad need your help to find this man. On Monday the 9th of October, he robbed a building society on the Broadway in Stratford, East London. He threatened members of staff with a revolver and once they'd handed over some cash, he made his getaway on foot, running along Stratford Broadway towards Bow. He's in his early 20s, 5 foot five to 5 foot six, and of slim build. A reward is being offered, so if you recognise him, please let us know. And finally, West Yorkshire Police would like to hear from you if you know the whereabouts of Alexander Bryans, his wife June, and their daughter Samantha. They may have information about a series of frauds dating back to 1987. You may know them as the Lewis family, the Lewisons, or the Robertsons, and we think that they were recently based in the Liverpool area. Mr. Bryans is 5 foot 7 inches tall, slim build, and has June tattooed on his left forearm. We think that his hair is now light brown. His wife is 5 foot four and of slim build and has a heavily pockmarked face. Samantha Bryans is just 5 foot two and, like her parents, has a Scottish accent, although not quite as strong. If you recognise the Bryans or any of our other photo call faces, please get in touch.
01-811-8055, the number if there's anyone you think you recognise. 01-811-8055.
And we're getting more calls on our first photo call file earlier on in the programme. More sightings of Richard Denick, including one in Blackpool, and a lot more sightings of Paul Bennett's helicopter. So we'll keep you posted on that later on. If you've been trying to get through without success, do please keep trying. The lines are open for the next hour and a half. The relevant police numbers are all on CFAX, page 186, and we'll show them to you again after our update programme, which follows question time at 11:15 tonight. Also, you can find out what's been happening as a result of viewers' calls by switching on to Daytime Live after midday tomorrow, when I'll be back here in this studio with the latest news on all this evening's cases.
And don't forget, you can always write to us, Crimewatch UK, BBC TV, London W12, 7RJ. Now, we often say on Crime Watch that violent crime is rarer than people tend to think, and it's true, despite some headlines this week suggesting violent crime is rising. In fact, a new report, an internal Home Office analysis, shows that the official statistics are misleading if they're taken at face value. The apparent rise in violent crime is largely due to a greater readiness by all of us to report crime to the police. And what's more, police now recognise more reports of crimes as serious enough to be recorded. For example, 2.5 times as many women are prepared to report domestic violence to the police now than would have done just 7 years ago. And there's something else that the study shows. Those who feel most vulnerable are those who tend to be the least at risk. So rest assured, despite all you've seen, heard tonight, don't have nightmares, do please sleep well. Good night.
Good night. Welcome back. It's been a busy night on the phones here, with a good response from viewers on most of our cases. In fact, we've had 100 calls on one of our photo call cases in particular, so it's with photo call that we'll start. Nick.
What's been the response, David?
Well, a mixed response, Nick. Some poor, some very good. First of all, we were looking for that Beaconsfield duo who'd committed... tried to obtain some travellers' cheques. Well, we've had 17 calls on then, giving us a possible address in the High Wycombe area.
Right, that was both between Beaconsfield and Hertfordshire that was linked. Yes. What about Richard Denick? He was the murderer who's escaped from Lewes Jail.
Well, we've had a dozen calls on him, sightings in Devon, and a couple of other leads through newspapers that might tie in with giving us a fix on where he is now.
OK, the two armed robbers then and Kingston in Surrey.
Yes, we've had 9 calls here and a similar number to New Scotland Yard, to the flying squad. We've had the same pair of names from 2 different callers, which is hopefully, too much of a coincidence to be untrue.
Golf 010 Whiskey was the registration number of a helicopter you've been trying to find.
Yes, that bug-eyed helicopter. Well, we've had 100 calls here to the studio and over 50 to Aberdeen as well. Numerous sightings of where that helicopter has been, including a couple possibly in Miami where it was an exhibition. And we've also had sightings of Paul Bennett as well, so hopefully we may be able to track him down.
What about the gem thieves? Stole some jewellery from Christchurch.
Yes, this was the couple who were either Asian or Arabic. Well, we've had numerous calls, including a possible address in the East London area, and other possible sightings and similar kinds of offences, including Huddersfield, London, Dorset, etc.
Paul Cook. Police wanted to interview this man. No relation to Sue, I hasten to say.
Yes, a lot of people who say they've done business with Paul Cook. He's allegedly hired a car from someone. Further business details. Even someone who claims that Cook was his best man, and when they last saw him recently, said, it'll be all right in October because I'm going to America.
What about the man who raided that building society in East London, was wearing sunglasses and caught by the security camera?
Yes, an amazing picture. Sadly, only two calls, a very poor response, and they're not very promising. So anybody who thinks they know that man, still call us now, please.
And the Bryans family, their father, mother and daughter.
Yes, numerous calls on them, including a regular pub that they might be using. We've even had a call from somebody who thinks that they're neighbours of the Bryans and tell us that the Bryans have gone on holiday. And coincidentally, a security guard from Gatwick called and said he thinks he saw them in the last couple of days going through.
A lot of calls to check up on. David, thank you. Sue.
And we also asked for your help to find whoever murdered 18-year-old Michelle Wareing after she left Scott's Disco in Wigan in the small hours of Saturday, September the 9th, Sunday the 10th. Police needed to know exactly what happened to Michelle after she set off for home a mile and a half away from Scott's. Mr. Smith, what sort of response have you had?
Well, quite a good response, about 60 telephone calls at the present time.
Quite sympathetic, but no strong leads yet?
No strong leads, quite a cross-section and a variety of different types of information.
The most important person you needed to trace was the man seen by the railings at the exit of the car park.
Certainly,
any news on him?
Certainly. He was overlooking the scene where Michelle Wareing was found. We have no definite lead on him yet, and I again appeal to him to come forward, contact us, or if anyone knows his identity, to get in touch straight away.
He was at that time at that place. Has anybody phoned in to say that they were one of the couples arguing?
No, not at the present time.
Again, that's something we need to know. So we need anybody who saw Michelle. We still need calls.
That's correct. After 1:10 a.m. on Sunday morning, the 10th of September, to contact us as soon as possible, please, yes.
And there is a reward of £5,000 offered by the Greater Manchester Police Authority, which is unique in this case.
That is correct, yes.
Mr. Smith, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now to that alarming raid on a travel agency in Newcastle upon Tyne. A highly excitable gang burst into the building, causing terror to staff and to customers.
Hey, go for it! Get down! Get down! Get down on the floor! Get down!
Fred Stevenson, you've had a pretty busy evening, haven't
you? Yes, indeed, yes. The phones never stop ringing, especially in Newcastle.
Now, what have you got that's interesting?
Well, you know, it's very important that we trace the whereabouts of the 4x4 Sierra.
That was the getaway car.
That's right.
Critical to this inquiry.
Well, what we have is a telephone call from Carlisle describing the original theft.
Now, we know it was stolen from Carlisle.
That's right, indeed. And certainly the caller is genuine. And if the information that has been given to us is genuine, then it could well lead to the original thieves, which is, of course, leads on to the next step and the next step, which is very exciting for us.
Good. I know you've also had some names offered, some of which are already known to you.
That's right, yes. We've had a number of well-known offenders mentioned, and we will follow every one of those up, of course.
OK. Anything else of great importance?
Nothing of great importance, but a number of suggestions where the bags may have come from.
Right.
And we're hopeful for that as
those
well.
Those are bags left behind at the scene.
Okay, but by far the best one is the one from Carlisle.
OK, thanks very much. Sue?
Somebody asked me just...
Well, we also appealed for your help to find the man who police believe is responsible for at least 8 attacks on women in prosperous areas of London. Our reconstruction showed how he tricked his way into one flat in Barnes, southwest London.
I live in the flat upstairs and I've got a leak. Have you got a bucket I could borrow?
Yeah, sure, I'll have a look. Is this size okay?
Well, first of all, Mr. Shorter, any sightings of this man?
There's been numerous sightings, especially in the areas that have been mentioned in the programme. Gloucester Road, Edgware Road and places like that.
So you've had a lot of calls?
Over 100.
Anybody recognises that particular description, if we can see him again?
Yes, we've had quite a few calls with and without the moustache, and from police officers and even prison wardens who think they might know him.
Right, and the French accent means you think he could be North African or French Moroccan or Algerian, perhaps?
Yes, could be.
What about the Rolex watches? Any information on those? Because they're quite distinctive.
They are indeed. Various people have rang in to say they've been offered watches and we'll contact them in the very near future.
Right. And the Mappin and Webb watch? Somebody needed to know what the serial number was, so
yes,
you can see that.
And that's going to be displayed downstairs.
OK, it's 1921484. All the lines, I gather, are jammed at the incident room.
They are, and if they can't get through, please keep trying. If not, any police station, and just mention the Barnes incident.
Right. Mr. Shorter, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, now to incident desk. Actually, there's been quite a disappointing number of calls coming in on many of these appeals. David, what's been happening?
Well, first of all, can we just go back to photo call, Nick, and Paul Bennett? We've had quite a few sightings of him. We didn't show him earlier, but if somebody's watching and knows where he is now, still call us. Because
several
like
people think they know where he is. Need to be checked up, of course.
Yes, sorry.
On incident desk, the Elizabeth McCormack murder.
Yes, an absolutely tragic case, atrocious case, a very poor response, only four calls. All we need is to trace an Asian man who was seen near Elizabeth's home on the 19th of September, when she was murdered.
He seemed to be covered in blood as he was walking down the
That's
street.
That's right, yes, blood on his clothing. Also, of course, anybody who thinks they saw Elizabeth McCormack as she was making her way home that evening. She was very distinctive in a bright pink cerise skirt and white blouse.
OK, we really want to get more on that. On the Manor House robbery, I know just very, very briefly, you've had quite a number of calls, anything in particular?
Yes, mostly concerning people having been offered stamps that were stolen. Remember, there was a range of valuable stamps. And we've also had a couple of names suggested that tie in with the Lincolnshire and also with the Avon and Somerset area. We've also had a name suggested for the guy who was guarding one of the victims, who we thought was a Marine.
OK, thank you very much. Sue?
Well, that's it for tonight. The lines here to the studio are still open. They close at midnight. And all the relevant police numbers will be on your screen in a moment. If you'd like to write to us, the address is Crimewatch UK, BBC Television, London W12 7RJ. I'll be back in this studio on Daytime Live after midday tomorrow, when you can find out all the latest news on what's been happening as a result of tonight's calls here.
And Crimewatch will be back a month from now, by which time, with luck and your help, many of the crimes that we've been looking at tonight will be well on the way to being solved. So don't have nightmares, do sleep well. Good night.
Good night.
Walk up to another crime scene.